Before I start off, brief kind of some additional introduction about me. I'm Nitin Dhal, and I started on this agile journey in about 2004. And I can say that since then, all the projects that I've done, executed, delivered, whatever, has been using agile methodologies or agile practices or whatever you call it. When I talk about agile and large projects or distributed projects, so briefly I call this a scaling agile. And in my terms, I also call it's like training an elephant to dance. We'll touch upon this during the session in terms of why I think it's an elephant and why an elephant dance. So the way I've kind of structured this is, we'll look at what makes agile work. We'll touch upon defining the scale. We'll touch upon what happens to agility when we start to scale. And we'll look at how can we possibly retain agility as we are scaling up. And towards the end, in staying on course, I'll touch upon certain matrices, certain information radiators and kind of things that kind of work for us. But before I kind of start off on this, I want to remind everyone of one thing which Tathagat said in the morning, which is when we look at kind of presentations like this, we tend to think a lot in terms of best practices and this is what has worked and probably will work. But I think more than that, what is more important is why part of it. So what I'm going to be talking about is basically a distill of my experience of what worked for us and certain things which didn't work for us or what journey that we went through. But your context is different. Your team is different. What you are doing is different. Like every project is different. So what I would request everyone is try to get the why part of it. And how about is something is a suggestion that you guys can figure out or kind of find your journey on this path. Few more things. Structure our talk. It's pretty non-linear. There isn't like building on top of one concept or the other. There are multiple areas that I'm going to touch upon which are varied. It assumes some knowledge of agile, so I'm not talking about the basics of agile or why and pay programming or anything like that. Please feel free to stop and ask questions. I think that's more important. Even if I'm not able to run through all the slides, that's fine, I can share the slide deck as well. But having a conversation in the economy is much more important. So feel free to stop wherever you want. And if there are questions which we're not able to answer, which probably are not in line with this, I'll try to put those in parking lot, take up at the end, or maybe after the session. Does it work? Is that okay? Cool. To start off with, let's say, why agile works? Do we think agile works? Why does it work?
It makes the planning easy in smaller sprints.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Pretty well. So what are the three main kind of areas which I think which makes agile work? First one, as you said, faster feedback loops. There are multiple feedback loops that are built into the practices that are built into the thought process. So you don't even have, it's not only a feedback loop from the customer. We have feedback loop from the team itself in terms of communication. Your most important feedback loop is from your CI process, is from the test that you have written, automated test. And then you have a periodical, at least I would say a periodical feedback from the customer in terms of your showcases and things like that. So that to me is one of the key strengths in terms of agile. The other one, decisions are made by relevant stakeholders. There is a reason why there is so much of discussion about agile team being a self-sufficient team. You need to have all the roles. Customer needs to be co-located, because when a situation emerges, you need to be able to go and talk to the right person and take a decision then, and that's one of the key thoughts of agile. That's how the team can actually be agile and respond to those situations, rather than, oh, I have a thing, I've sent a mail to the customer, they'll reply in 3 days, and then we'll see. That's not going to make us agile. The third thing is about flexibility in solution process. The key things about agile team is you need to have courage and you need to have empowered teams. Courage to be able to make decisions, courage to be able to make refactorings, courage to be able to drive a solution in line with the evolving situations. That and empowering of the teams is, so economy, these three are the key things which I think makes agile work. Agree, disagree? Make sense? Heavy lunch, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. So when we look at a typical agile team, what does an agile team look like? Something like this. You have a team, five, six members. All the roles are there. You have a PM, you have a BA, you have a QA, whatever you can think of. You have a storyboard, someone owns the storyboard. You have your own CI cycle, which includes a code repository, includes a cruise control like tool, which is your build tool, includes a gets your installables, pretty much self-sufficient. That's a typical agile team the way I think most of us imagine, or at least I imagine. That is a typical agile team, and we're talking about scaling here. What is scale? What do we mean by scaling? Anyone?
So scaling is about being able to deliver more in those 15 days by expanding your capacity.
Okay. That's a good point. Anyone else? First is team organization. So the one big team is impossible to manage. There's no way you can actually do that. So you have to look at creating some sort of smaller units or kind of finding a way to do that. Continuous integration becomes a problem. If it is not modularized, if the deployments are not figured out, and if all of these teams are checking in at the same time, none of the systems are able to scale. I mean, my guys are not getting feedback at the right time. Planning becomes a problem because each team is kind of planning their own stuff, doing their own things. But aggregation is a problem because no one understands the bigger picture. The guy who understands the bigger picture is not able to kind of bring everyone onto the same page at the same time. And communication breaks down. I mean, face-to-face communication has a limitation. I can probably talk to 5 people, 10 people, 15, 20 maximum. Beyond that, there's no way I can actually talk to the entire team face-to-face on a daily basis. So what happens is when we look at these challenges, the teams which was initially were small, was really fast, was really agile, was able to respond to whatever comes their way, is now sluggish, is now slow, it takes time to turn around anything, it takes time to even answer, get a question answered, is just sluggish and slow, which I think becomes like an elephant. It takes time to turn, it takes time to sit, it takes time to stand, and that is why I believe that if you want to scale, you'll actually have to make that elephant dance. That's the only way you can actually scale agile. Make sense? Yes? No?
Yes.
Wake up, guys. Okay, so what I'll do next is I'll touch upon those four challenges that I kind of spoke about in terms of what our thoughts were and how we kind of tried to address those. First one being the team organization. Now, typically in an agile team, we say the team needs to be heavy on self-organization, shared ownership and responsibilities, it needs to be end-to-end. Those principles are really good, but if you're scaling, I think you have to tilt the balance slightly towards separation of concerns. You might have to create specialized and centralized roles, and you'll have to make sure that modular development is possible. There's no way you can actually look at a big solution in one way. So if you look at, and mind it, what I'm saying is tilt the balance slightly. If you go all the way that side, that's a different set of problems we'll encounter. So how we try to do that is we kind of structure the teams in this fashion. Yeah. So we have all of those multiple teams that we spoke about. I'm showing four. We actually, even in the project where we had about 220 people, we had 8 of those teams sitting out there. Each team is pretty independent in terms of doing end-to-end work. That principle has to be maintained. We're not breaking it down in terms of, hey, you guys are front-end teams, you guys are API teams. You guys are technical teams, you guys are something else. No. You have to end-to-end, it has to be functional, you have to break down functionality in a way that these are pretty independent. They have their own card walls, they have their own backlogs, everything. But then there needs to be a decent amount of central function here, which is making sure that all of these things are actually put together. So someone who is out there making sure that when things are being planned, the bigger picture is in mind, and then recombining everything to make sure that the bigger picture is not getting lost. Does that make sense? So we had things like what you can call a product owner, you could call a program VA, you could call a program manager, some of those roles kind of sitting there. Also, need to make sure that all of these card walls are actually rolling up into a single one so that we have somewhere a picture of what is happening across all the team, what is happening in the program. But at the end of the day, all of these things need to deliver at a single piece. It's a single system still, right? To make sure that the system remains single, the central piece to whole thing is our continuous integration. All of these teams will still check into the same repository, but have the same CI pipeline that they will actually work across. This throws a different challenge which I'll talk about in terms of CI itself, but that's the principle. At no point I'm letting a team go and integrate within themselves and saying, yes, we have delivered it. It needs to integrate across continuously, automatically, and then whatever is delivered needs to be showcased to the customer at whatever interval you want, 1 week, 2 weeks, as a whole piece. You cannot have team-wise broken down things. Any questions so far? Does it make sense? No? I can't hear anything.
Thank you.
say that depending on your starting point. My starting point was the central team is one person, and you have 8 of these distributed teams. From there, yes, we are adding density. But if you are starting from a point where you have a pretty heavy central team, then maybe it goes the other way around. And that's why I say, why we have done certain things, why there are only 2 people there, why those roles are there, you have to question and be minimalistic about it. Otherwise, if you have a central team already, you are kind of breaking down this way, you might end up adding density to the wrong place.
When the teams are located at 3 different locations separated by time zones?
Okay, so I mean we did have that and pretty much the same principles. CI again needs to be central, there is no way I am actually letting go of that principle. In terms of teams, the challenge that you have is not everyone is co-located. So you have to have the mechanisms in terms of how do we make sure that the teams are, your distributed team is not completely out of sync. So if, I mean, we tried things from using as much technology as possible in terms of using things like video calls and having stand-ups and making sure that on a daily basis there are multiple of those communications happening to actually getting people to travel. Honestly, when I was running the program, I was on the flight 2 weeks in a month because there's no way I could actually sit in one place and have all of those things. So we actually did a combination of both of those. That somewhere that whole co-location thing has to be brought in. You cannot be ideal to it, but you can't just say, okay, it's not possible.
And do you also face challenges due to the preferences of people? Because honestly speaking, like we in India, we are fairly open, actually rather excited to move to different locations, Western locations. But if we do like the other way around, when we ask people from maybe London or Pisa, like in our office, to come and join us for a sprint, they have their different apprehensions.
Okay.
So did you face that problem and is there something that we can do to work on the mindset or?
Sure. I would say yes and no. So typically the problem I've seen is right at the beginning of an engagement, all of it. But once we have been able to get some of our people to go there and sit with them, and they actually, Musa, they actually look at, and this is typically the customer case, right? It's not your own team. And once people have seen the impact of co-location, I have seen them a lot more open to actually traveling and spending time here. So luckily, in our case, once we had that, saying, look, if I get 3 people here, this is the impact. But if you come there with that 100 people, the impact is going to be much better. And it is for your benefit, it is for your business. I mean, we are not doing it because we want you to be sitting there. We want you to be sitting there, but we can actually deliver the right value to your business. The thing was that message goes across, and once people try it once, then it becomes a lot more easy. For example, in a couple of my projects, I've had things where the customer from UK would actually come and sit with us for 2 weeks, 3 weeks at a time, and that will happen every quarter. To a time where we were actually doing a project that was distributed with Brazil. Nightmare in terms of language and time zones, but what worked for us is we had about 5 people from India sitting in Brazil and 5 of them sitting in India for the whole duration of the project. That I mean, those things, there's no, I have not been able to find any other way of them be letting any people to travel. Second thing, continuous integration. That to me is a very central piece, and why is, what are the kind of challenges that come there? You get more code by all of these scale teams, by all of these different teams coming in, which means more dependencies, which means more conflicts. impact of broken builds. We ran into situations where out of the 220 people, there were only 10 check-ins in a day because the build broke and someone checked in and someone checked in on a broken build, and then you don't know what is happening and you get those people in the room, guys, go figure it out, or you're rolling back. By the time the whole thing was done, it was the day was gone. And at that level, people who are doing multiple check-ins in a day, you talk about 10 check-ins in a 220 member team, that's a complete loss of productivity. You haven't achieved anything on that day. So that was a pretty big problem for us to try to kind of think about and solve. And then the design of build infrastructure itself, I mean, how much time does it take to provide feedback? What is the architecture? I mean, what do you want to do, single build versus multiple build, pipeline? And finally, a question comes when you start scaling in terms of what is the maintenance cost of it? If it is flaky, then how much money are you going to throw at maintaining this? So, I mean, the kind of solution that worked for us in terms of the pipeline was something like this. For our trunk, we had a... Ouch, the color's not coming up. So what we have is something called a developer build, basically, which is the most common thing where it takes the code, compiles it, runs all the unit tests, passes, throws it up. The next step, what it does is, it actually builds the environment and installs that whatever has been thrown out. You run a rest, a kind of a smoke test on it, which is making sure that from a UI perspective, or a function perspective, yeah, the basic flow is working. And then you kind of go about saying, my dev artifact is out, this is fine. Each of these are things which we had to come to a level where we could actually parallelize these. So even though the dependencies, once this is done, second part of the build has picked it up, this guy will pick up the next check-in and continue. In parallel, once the dev build is out, second pipeline will take that build, put it out here, install it, will run your entire regression suite on it, and then it will say whether this is a build which is good for publication or not. And that kind of setup we had replicated now for trunk and for every branch that you kind of create. And that, to me, was one of the key things that actually enabled us to get that kind of throughput. Without parallelization, distribution, modularization, it was just impossible because we are running time and again running into issues where the build is broken and I can't check in and my day is lost. Make sense? Has you faced those kind of problems?
Yes, we actually had 12-hour long builds. So that 12-hour long test that we did, that we actually replicated into 12 virtual machines on Amazon,
yeah.
And then we actually did it in like 1 hour.
Actually, when today with cloud and all that, it makes it a lot more simpler. It makes it a lot more simpler. Planning. What do we need to kind of think about planning if we have a setup like this and you're scaling across multiple teams? So key things that we did was, one is planning has to across team and it has to be functional. As I said earlier, there's no way we were actually letting go of the principle that the teams are not end-to-end. The teams have to be end-to-end. We need to make sure that they're delivering functionality which is from the beginning to the last piece. We're not dividing them technically or doing things like that. Also, I mean, there were specialized functions which are helping them. So you have product owner which is central, who is kind of looking at what the goal is, where the product is heading, and then making sure that all the team plans which are being created are actually in line with it. So that's how we kind of started with planning things. Rollup of plans was very important. We had to actually find the right tools to make sure that all the iterations across teams are actually kind of combining into one, wherein we could find a release, or the releases are kind of getting into a product, and different stakeholders are able to look at it at different levels. Otherwise, you'll have each of those teams kind of running with their own plans, and there's no way you will know that what is happening at the product level. And pictorially, you would say that this is where my iteration plans are. They kind of roll up into what release plans look like, which kind of go into multiple versions of the product. And the way we did it was, we had a tool which was where we could actually trace all of it. So you're not talking about maintaining three different set of backlogs. You're talking about just maintaining it here and kind of automatically rolls up and up and up. Yeah, there are multiple tools. Well, today there are a lot of tools available. Even Jira has a lot of capabilities built into it. There's Mingle which has capabilities built into it. A lot of those tools are quite easily available. when you do things like you could put features in place and all of it, you could track, you could say, here's my feature, it's broken down into these stories, and this is actually some feature, the sub-feature goes into feature, the feature goes into release. So you, those tree structures are available in a lot of places. No, so when I say trunk, basically, I'm talking about your version control. So you have a branch, which is release branch, you have your trunk where your development is going on. When I talk about CI, what I was saying was that kind of parallelization of build and making sure that the feedback loop doesn't get too long. You still get about half an hour, 20 minutes, 10 minutes, that kind of feedback.
So that is sort of different implications for different releases?
Yes. You check in with the smallest piece. So I make a change, I check in. So the way we kind of work is a developer will probably check in, I would say, 3 to 4 times a day.
Depends on module dependencies,
like I'm working on module dependencies or module feed. So that's where, if you look at it, the module structure is very important. What you need to make sure is, if it is tightly coupled, then I would say please connect all from 1D. If it is not tightly coupled, then you have your interfaces defined. You can look at an interface and develop against that interface. The other team will develop against that interface. There are definitely things where the same file needs to be changed. Wherein whosoever goes in first wins and someone else will have to kind of merge it. But the key thing there is, if you are actually checking in small pieces, if a developer is checking in say about 3 times a day, then there's no way that you can actually get like a huge change set and you don't know how to resolve it. The resolution becomes pretty easy and fast. And I would say more than compatibility, what is also required is you need to have infrastructure which supports them. Like if I check in and if I get feedback from that, then people will be open to checking in. Otherwise there's no point. Why should I put all that effort in? You guys with me? Okay. So moving on from here, the last thing there on that list was about communication. Now, what could be? I mean, the key challenges that we faced were like, with the scaling, you had limited face-to-face communication. There is no consistent view of a big picture in terms of where it is, how it is, no one understands. The lack of clarity of relationship, ownership, decision-making was a problem, knowledge sharing was a problem. And so the ideas which kind of worked for us were formal and scheduled communications. We use things like, for example, after a stand-up, we make sure that at least one person from every team comes together and does something what in Scrum is called Scrum of Scrums. Which is, if I have 8 teams, you do your stand-ups, you know where you are, one person from those teams come together and you have another stand-up which is across teams. So, if I'm standing there, I know what is happening in each of the teams and I can go back and radiate to my team. And I don't have 220 people on the phone and standing in a room like this and saying what I did yesterday and whatever roadblocks. First thing, information radiators. That was pretty important for us. A lot of program updates, charts that we kind of put together. There are times when we used to get the whole program together and do program updates. There is no way for us to go and talk to all of these people and make sure that everyone is on the same page. So you would actually do feature updates, you would do program updates, you'll see where it is happening. At times we have to schedule it as well. Not informal communication doesn't work always. Particular escalation points. And a lot of effort that we had to put in was in terms of building communities and forums. You had your organization-wide communities, but then this itself starts to become an elephant that you need to kind of tackle. So there were communities which we had to build within the project teams, within the program teams, which is in that context. And that was one kind of a successful way for us to kind of share knowledge and have kind of communication going across across locations, because people kind of felt related to the community. Yes, I know all the queue they're talking about, this tool they're talking about, what the other team is doing, and they would kind of feel excited about it. That to us kind of helped quite a bit in terms of kind of nurturing and building those communities within the program. Any questions, comments so far? Because from there I'll move on to kind of staying on course and talk about some of the radiators, some of the matrices that kind of work for us. Any questions, comments?
Can you explain a bit more about the roles which you got in that central team?
Okay. So central team had roles like I had a program PA slash product owner, which was responsible for working with the product management team, making sure they understand what the bigger picture is, and then working with the respective teams to make sure that their whatever planning they are doing is in line with it, and the whole back and forth was being done there. We had a central role which we called as a person who owns development, whose primary responsibility was to make sure that the iterations across these teams are kind of rolling up into one and are being delivered as one. Someone needs to have that view. For example, one of my teams could be doing really well, one of our team is struggling, which means as a program we are failing. Someone needs to take the call of rebalancing it and how things are working across team. If I have to pull someone here, get them there, so that was one part of it. Then we had a central role of a person who is actually, we called the person release manager. That person's responsibility was to take, because DevOps was not really, we were kind of starting experimenting with DevOps at that point of time. So his responsibility was to take that final product and then work it through the customer organization to get it out in production. That used to take about a week to just run through their operations. And then I had a central role which we called the program manager, which was kind of responsible for making sure that the whole program addresses and all of these things are collected, and the right kind of information at that governance level is being passed on to the customer as well as radiated back to the team. So those are the kind of central roles that we have.
Do you also have some kind of technical architecture to ensure that all these different pieces are working together in terms of overall architecture?
Yeah, so I mean, the architect role was actually split between the teams. I mean, you had one person as part of a team which is kind of more central, a couple of people more central. These guys should come together and manage it that way, rather than designating one central architect, because that when we tried experimenting with it, that was putting so much of central control in kind of every day's work that was not scaling well. So we had like a bunch of people kind of getting together and doing it.
So what is the frequency of your release?
And we were releasing once in 8 weeks.
Four sprints.
After the other one, the interesting is not done.
So we were taking a call a day before or whatever story we need to pull up.
So there is something called a hangover that you cannot. There will always be cases where something will get pushed out, something will get pushed in. But then the idea is that we used to deal in terms of 120 stories in 2 weeks. Out of the 120 stories, 100 stories are done, 20 stories I know are in testing all of it. Yes, that's a hangover. But the 100 stories which are done, if you want me to push it to production, I can do it now.
Did you have any hardening cycle?
It was also, I think it was also a UI heavy product. It's a product which is like a e-commerce solution. So the UI element needs to be tested manually. There's no other way of it.
Was it done like after every sprint or after at the end of the release?
After every iteration, we would give them a build to make sure that whatever is being done is actually ready. So once everything is okay, your automation tests are anyway running in passing. You would actually give a build out to their what you call a system acceptance testing team, and they would kind of start on that. And next iteration, you would get the next build out. So if you want production, you can take it. Depend on the priority. If it is higher priority, I will do the next iteration, which would mean that I might want to reprioritize something, you might want to push something out. But if you want this to get into, say, two iterations later, that's fine. But depends on, it's a call that customer has to take.
The
bug?
It keeps, because the change keeps coming.
The bucket is fixed for iteration. This is my bucket for iteration, this is what I can do. Right? You can swap and swap out anytime. Any story which is already in play, you cannot swap out. That's like a complete waste. You should not do that.
How about the review and retrospective? We have to involve all the teams together, or we take from each?
The way it is, it makes a lot more sense to be in a team which is quite cohesive. Otherwise, it will not become a retrospective. It will be like, yeah, everything is good, and that's where we will end. But we would also do a retrospective which will come across the team. So we get a couple of people from every team and do a program level retrospective. Again, making sure that the dynamics of the group is pretty important there. I think that's something that we have to keep in mind, that real issues start to come out and people are feel safe talking there. Otherwise, it's like, yeah, there are so many good cards and there are no problems in the program. When you say review, what do you mean? The product demo would actually break it down. You would not modify, but probably more in terms of function levels and do it that way. So there are demos which should run for about hour, hour and a half, 2 hours as well.
So typically, we do it on the last iteration?
Yes, at the end of the iteration.
So how do we segregate the value streams in a distributed product?
Sorry, come again?
If you had a distributed team structure, right? So how did you segregate the different value streams? Were there any basis on which you did it, or?
We primarily did it based on functionality. Primarily, so functionality is something that, one of the principles that we said will not dilute is every team has to be functional, every team has to be end to end. So you could take slices and functionalities and do it. What we not do is, hey, you do the UI of it and that team will do the API of it. That won't work.
You had component and functionality at every specific location, so Peter, that means, or?
Yes, so each of those teams were delivering end-to-end functionalities.
They would like to reuse from each other. So how do they kind of coordinate those and ensure that they are not appreciating the work, reinventing the wheel also.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so the easiest way to do things is abstract your whole API setup. We are doing something very similar in one of our projects this year. It is, and it is built for scaling. So everything is modernized, APIs and everything is out. So you actually look at everything is common, is sent out as an API. You only do the platform specific stuff in those cases. Because otherwise, there is, if you look at those two, right? If you, outside the backend functionality, there is nothing much common. In the user paradigm, that's so different.
In the interest of the time, I would just request to take any questions during the tea break.
Sure thing. So I've kind of run through most of it. What is left is what I said, the staying on course. So wherein what I have put in is a set of charts and graphs and things like that that you are using. So any questions on that, I'm happy to take on. But just quickly run through the kind of things like some of these kind of charts and graphs that you are using across teams and dashboard that you are building. Sorry? I don't have it, but I'll upload it. So that's okay. I can share the slide deck. There's nothing like that in it. And if anyone is interested in it, you can have a panel this anytime. Cool. Thank you.
Thanks, Mohit. Thanks, Atin. I would like to call upon Mohit Jain to hand over a memento to Nitin. Thank you.